Yeah, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairman. What I want to present here is a cooperation of three different Viennese universities, and it is part of the PhD thesis of Martin Walter, which could not make to come here personally. As you might imagine from this long and very detailed title, it's a very specific problem which I want to touch, but I think it is of general interest and importance because it's about a very hot topic. It's about asbestos. Asbestos is a mineral which is used since more than 100 years very extensively in industry because of its special physical properties. It's the high fire and heat resistance, the resistance against chemical and biological weathering, its high flexibility and the high tensile strength of its fibers. So, mostly used in buildings as insulation material, but it's also found in many consumer applications like hair dryers, toasters, pharmaceutics, cosmetics, even as filters for the beer production. But as we know today, it's also very dangerous. It's there are a lot of very dangerous disease. For example, it's the second most cause for cancer of lung after tobacco. So it is since approximately 20 years forbidden in the European Union and several other countries according to a recommendation of the WHO. But it's still used in many other countries very extensively, like the US or China, even India. Asbestos is a commercial term for six different silicate minerals. 95% of the historical used one is chrysotile with this chemical formula. It consists of alternating layers of octahedral magnesium hydroxide and tetrahedral silicon sites, which are bundled up to such fibers with the outermost layer being octahedral magnesium hydroxide. Why is it so dangerous? There are several reasons. It's the slow dissolution kinetics, the morphology, and the surface reactivity. For example, the large aspect ratio leads to continuous but unsuccessful attempts of the macrophages to remove these fibers. This unsuccessful phagocytosis causes a permanent immune reaction, and this leads to chronic inflammation during which reactive oxygen species like hydrogen peroxide or superoxide are released into the extracellular environment and thus triggering the formation of tumors. These reactive oxygen species can react with active sites on the fiber surface. Iron in chrysotile, which is approximately 2 white percent, is known to catalyze the formation of hydroxyl radicals out from the hydrogen peroxide at the fiber surface in a Haber-Weiss redox cycle. Superoxide, which comes from the iron-mediated decomposition of hydrogen peroxide, reduces the ferric iron to ferrous iron, and in the second step, with the help of hydrogen peroxide, it oxidizes again the iron, and in this second step, the so-called Fenton reaction, also the very reactive hydroxyl radicals are formed. Now, it's an interesting point that the reactivity of iron oxides and iron hydroxides to form these high hydroxyl radicals is orders of magnitude slower than in the case of chrysotile, and the question is why is this the case? So this question was tackled by so-called dissolution experiments, and we have used a lot of different methods to characterize the results. For example, Mössbauer experiments gave the type and the amount of the different iron species. Optical emission spectroscopy was used for trace metal analysis. Electron paramagnetic resonance gave information about the radical formation with the help of spin trapping, DMPO, which interacts with the radicals forming such metastable DMPO OH, and this could be quantified by the EPR measurements. In the pristine chrysotile fibers, we have found three different iron species. By Mössbauer analysis, 26% of ferrous and 37% of ferric iron in orthogonal in the aortic octahedral magnesium layers and ferric iron in tetrahedral places in the silicon layers. 32% of all the iron atoms are in magnetite impurities, which is, according to X-ray investigations, approximately 2% of the whole chrysotile material. This is a sketch of the chrysotile fibers during the dissolution process. Green stands for the outer magnesium layer, yellow for the next silicon layer. These red rectangles are the octahedral iron atoms in the magnesium layer, and the red circles are the tetrahedral iron atoms in the exposed silicon layer. Now, putting the pristine fibers into a physiologically pH 7.4 solution, the mobilized magnesium content increases quickly up to approximately 500 to 600 micromoles per liter, and this amount corresponds exactly to the magnesium concentration of the outermost magnesium layer. The dissolution then stops because of the bad solubility of the silicon. Now the octahedral ions of the dissoluted magnesium layer precipitate on the now exposed silicon layer as secondary precipitates like ferrihydrite. The tetrahedral iron atoms in the silicon layer remain in situ. This fiber is now called the so-called Planck altered fiber. Now, in the presence of iron chelating DFOB, the outermost magnesium layer dissolute in the same way, similar way here, but the octahedral iron atoms are now complexed by the DFOB ligand, so they do not precipitate on the fiber. And this DFOB also mobilizes now the tetrahedral iron atoms in the exposed silicon layer, thus forming vacancies in the silicon layer, and this leads to an enhancement of the solubility of silicon. This fiber is now called the DFOB-altered fiber. And putting this DFOB-altered fiber again for up to 2 weeks into a physiological solution, the mobilization of magnesium and silicon increases linearly up to 200 and 120 micromoles per liter. However, when putting an extra iron, 3 micromole per gram extra iron or 30 micromoles per gram extra iron on the fiber surface, the dissolution rate drastically is reduced. Due to the fact that these iron atoms go into the vacancies of the exposed silicon layer. Putting 300 micromoles per gram extra iron on the fibers does not further decrease the dissolution rate, most likely because all the vacancies are already filled up with iron atoms. This is confirmed by the Mössbauer spectra measurements. The tetrahedrally coordinated ferric iron atoms of the DFOB altered fibers are decreased from the 7% in the pristine fibers to only 3.8% because of the depletion of iron by the DFOB treatment. Precipitation of 3 micromole per gram extra iron on the DFOB altered fibers increases this tetrahedrally coordinated ferric iron fraction clearly by approximately 70% from 3.8 to 6.5%. The mobilization of magnesium and silicon in case of the Planck altered fibers is much smaller. It goes only up to 75 and 35 micromoles per liter. This is caused by the absence of vacancies in the Planck altered fiber. Therefore also the precipitation of 330 or 300 micromole extra iron on the fiber surface decreases the dissolution rate much less than in case of the DFOB altered fibers. This is again confirmed by the Mössbauer measurements. The tetrahedrally coordinated ferric iron atoms only slightly decrease from the 7% of the pristine fibers to only to now 5.9% in the Planck altered fiber, and the precipitation of 3 micromoles per gram extra iron of the Planck altered fibers did not really change. the tetrahedral iron amount, it only goes from 5.9 to 5.6%. Looking now the relation of the pristine fiber, relation to the pristine fiber, the radical, the hydroxyl radical formation gain is less than 10%, because all the exposed iron atoms from the outermost magnesium layer and also from the exposed silicon layers, so the ortho and the tetrahedral ones, are complexed by DFOB. This is not the case in for the blank altered fibers. Here we have a yield of 60%, because here on the blank altered fibers there are no vacancies in the exposed silicon layer. If we now put 330 or 300 micromoles per gram extra iron on the fibers, we have for the DFOB altered fibers a successive increase up to 40%. In case of the blank altered fibers within the error bars, there is practically no change. So the precipitation of only 3 micromoles per gram extra iron, this corresponds to 1.8 micrograms iron, increases the yield by more than 10%. A similar yield for the hydroxyl radicals is found in case of 1.8 milligrams of orthogonal iron in the ferrihydrides. So we see that the reactivity of the tetrahedral iron atoms in the silicon layer of the chrysolite is approximately 1,000 times higher than in case of the orthogonal iron atoms of the ferrihydride. So what our experiments have demonstrated is that the tetrahedral iron, and only the tetrahedral iron in the silicon layers of the chrysotile, is capable of generating these highly reactive hydroxyl radicals in the Haber-Weiss redox cycle. And this may be important for the pathogenetic of asbestos-associated disease. And further, we have demonstrated that external iron may be incorporated in vacancies in the silicon layer of asbestos and thereby become highly redox active. This also may be important for pathogenic fibrous minerals which have no bulk tetrahedral iron, for example, in fibrous zeolites. We further have shown, I had no time to show the data, that this tetrahedral iron, ferric iron, is the preferred iron species in the chrysotile asbest-mediated decomposition of the hydrogen peroxide. And it's this tetrahedral iron which redox cycles between ferric and ferrous inside of the silicon layer of the chrysotile asbestos. And it seems to be that this redox cycling capability is the reason for this high reactivity of the chrysotile fibers. This high redox-redox reactivity of these ferric tetrahedral iron atoms in the crystalline silicon matrix, this may be used in future for forced oxidative degradation processes of organic contaminants. Thank you very much.